pressure switch. It's ridiculous. Why does this have a gauge? It made me crazy. Hey there, viewers, and welcome back to the Self-Made Auto Channel. I got this Jeep here. I think it's an 04-ish Grand Cherokee. Sounded like it had a 6-cylinder 4-liter in it there when I started up outside and brought it in. The guy just dropped it off. He just had it at another shop for inspection, and they found it because his engine light was on, and they said, we don't know why it's on. Gave him a couple codes. If I remember right from the code numbers he gave me, I think they were pertaining to some oxygen sensors, so I can't fathom what the other guys couldn't do, or you know, couldn't figure out. Maybe it's something a little more involved than just your normal O2 sensor swap. So let's have a look. So I went ahead and we got our Varus plugged in here, our scan module. On this vintage Jeep, you can actually flash the codes out of with the key. So I'll zoom in on that instrument cluster here. So we'll go on, off, on, off, on. So we got P0141 and a P0155. I think that's what he told me. And a 523. So we'll let the Varus here get all ID'd, see if this agrees with the codes. I believe those are O2 sensor codes. The P0523, I'm not real sure right offhand, but sometimes when you flash the codes, it'll flash codes that it won't have stored, you know, when you look at the scan tool. So I'm not, you know, 100% sure why I haven't really researched it, but so we'll see here what we have. Oh, we got them all. Okay, oil pressure sensor volts too high. Bank 2, sensor 1 heater failure. Bank 1, sensor 2 heater failure. Well, that seems pretty cut and dry, right? Well, I guess we'll just, what do we have here? 1, 2, 2, 1. Let's go have a look. O2 sensor orientation on this baby to see. I don't know if these got one or two. No, I must have four because we got a bank one and a bank two, so it has at least three, anyways, possibly four. Come under here, I guess. Well, you know what? We're grabbing some flashlight here. So there is an O2 sensor, split up into a couple converters. Got to be one above it. Yeah, there is. There's one up there under that intake manifold. Another one there towards the back. Got one more here. Yep, we got a nice oily one there. And another one way at the top there. So yeah, there's our two. Well, let's see here. And we've got two up top, so those are our, you know, upstreams, obviously. We've got to figure out which bank is which. I assume the one with the number one cylinder. Maybe we can figure it out here. This front converter, I assume, is, you know, by bank one, bank two. That's just a guess. We'll look that up. What was our code? We had a bank one sensor two heater. And that O2 sensor appears shiny. If we're right, if this is bank one, that would be sensor two. That O2 sensor looks shiny. But let's see if we got an issue right here. Ah, there's your problem, lady. Well, there, that's an easy fix on that one. Visual inspection, folks, that's key. and that is on the two white wires, so that's our heater circuit. Okay, so this one is a easy fix. That one needs a connector. So that is definitely bank one. What was our other code? Bank two sensor one heater. So that is gonna be our rear. That one we'll have to get from up top so we can let it back down. That O2 sensor looks old and crusty. So that one may just have a bad heater problem. That connector go? Not the wires. Well, here's an O2 sensor wire there. It's probably that front one. Might have to stick the camera down here. Yeah, I see some wires. Yep, it's way on the back. I just probably can't see it, but I see the connector back there. I don't know if you guys will be able to see that or not, but there she is hiding back there. Those two white wires going in our O2. Let's see if I can get that unplugged, get it up where we can test it. Get this air cleaner out of our way here. That gives us a little more room to work. It's got more than one screw holding it up. See one. About to find out, folks. Oh, great. That just popped off. First day checking an air filter. Don't mind me. Stupid Jeeps. There we go. That's a Jeep thing. Somebody might have been there already. Well, first thing we'll do is just real quick, we'll check the heater and the O2 sensor itself. We don't even need a wiring diagram for that. It's just the two wires that are the same color. Oops. We'll grab our little multimeter here. All right. And that should have, you know, some resistance. Pretty low resistance, 8 ohms, something like that maybe. Typically when they're bad, they're just open circuit, so. Let's see here. We'll get this set up on something other than what it is. Let's see. Ohmage. Auto. You folks see that? There, ohm. Maybe. Leave it right there, I think you got her there. That's their equipment. Pretty dang good. A couple probes. We'll front probe that thing without spreading the terminals. Okay. Here we go. I'm going in for the two white wires. White wire number one. That is white wire number two. And we have 3.6 ohms. Right, check your scale. Always check your scale. That's 3.6 ohmage. So that's good. It appears that that sensor is likely A-OK. What we need to do now is actually check heater function. Right, we were bank 2 sensor 1. Where's my clipboard? Yeah, bank 2 sensor 1 heater circuit. So now we have to check to see if the actual heater vehicle works. So I'll turn the key on. We should be able to just use our varus perhaps and turn that circuit on. And we'll grab our little scope on a rope make sure it works. Oh man, it sure is nice having the doors open finally. Winter really wasn't that long. We didn't have much of a winter. They only plowed snow one time. So that was good. That was short-lived anyways. So I'm not gonna use the meter here to check for power of that connector. You probably could, but you still have to determine whether or not it has the ability to carry current. So we will use our test light. What I'll do, so where this action sensor wire plugs in, you know, you got the two white wires, so we still don't really need to get a wire diagram. I'll get a couple connectors, a couple banana jack connectors from our U-test kit here. Where is that little guy? Showed this in a lot of other videos. Been using this a lot for stuff like this. It's that kit I picked up through AES Wave there. I have zipper problems. Alright, don't mind me, folks. Actually, I have had a little issue with one zipper here. Usually, if you pull out on it like that, it works. So, not a big deal. But we'll find out which one of these little guys we need. I think it's these blue ones. It's always the blue ones. Now, get them hooked up into that connector. We'll turn the key on and do our thing. So here we go. We'll take our mirrors. Just kind of set this here. Ended up being the little red connector is what I used in it. We'll go to function test. Nope. Oh yeah, maybe under function test, under ATM test. We got downstream O2 heater. PWM O2 heater relay 1-1. PWM O2 heater relay 2-1. We're working on something. 2-1. So we do PWM, so pulse width modulated. So it's probably fed a constant power, and then it is ground side switched, I would assume. So what we can do, we'll take our trusty test light, we'll check to see if one of these terminals has full-time power. The key is on right now. That one does not. That one does not. Wait a minute. O2 heater relay. Okay, so this probably turns on a relay than the PCM ground side switch. We may actually have to look. Let's see here. No communication. It's key on, it's asking me. Maybe my key's not on. Maybe I'm just lying to everybody. Key's on now, baby. All right, key's on. Let's recheck this here for power. Yeah, turn. No power. Let's turn this relay on. I just heard something click over there, so now we should have power. So we got power on that one. So this one must be our ground side switch. There it is. It's pulsing. Can you guys see that? Okay, so that means the PCM is in control. So we'll turn this off. It's off. It's on. All right. Back and check. And full-time power. So that's pretty interesting. I don't know why it has a code for that. I did see that wire was pigtailed up on that. So perhaps somebody had this unplugged and they were fiddling with stuff, set the code. I'm not sure, maybe the O2 is, we can look here, we can see what the value is supposed to be for the heater. So front upstream O2, heater test, resistance, 3.5 to 8.5 ohms at 70 degrees. I don't know how warm it is in here, it's hot today, it's like 64. So yeah, I cannot say that it needs that rear O2 sensor. As of right now, what we can do is see if it goes open circuit as it heats up. We can take it, just plug it in, let the O2 sensor get hot, we can turn that on. So maybe I'll do that. If I get any different results, I'll show you guys, but I'm just a little suspicious because that wire was all twirled up that maybe somebody was messing with this and set a code or something. And then in the meantime, I'll see if I can get a connector for the one down below and we can get that all fixed up. Pretty simple. Well, I've had the O2 sensor heater on for, several minutes here, maybe 5 minutes. What we'll do is we'll just plug back into it and see what the resistance value is. We had 3-something last time. So it should be nice and toasty now. I'll just leave it right on here. Take and unplug it. Across pin 1, pin 2, and I've got 4.9 ohms, 4.7, 4.9, somewhere right in there. So resistance just went up a little bit, but no open circuit. I'm gonna leave it. Quick visual inspection here on the wires, I guess. That'll be good. We've obviously moved it around quite a bit here. Give it the old reach around there because I can't see all of it. Everything feels good and smooth. We're leaving that one. So here's something worthy of mentioning. Keon, obviously we unplugged that. We're on the right O2 sensor anyways, because see, we've got our bank 2 sensor 1 heater failure and then 2 sensor 1 circuit low. And that circuit low is gonna be because we unplugged it. So that kind of kiboshes that myth, or the thought rather, not so much a myth, but the thought that, perhaps unplugging it, set that code when clearly it doesn't, it sets a low circuit code. Maybe it sets both. I tell you what, easy enough to do, key's still on. I think just for the sake of testing, let's unplug bank 1 sensor 1. See what codes we generate. Let's see here, might have to back out, back to codes. No code there. So what I'll do, maybe the heater has to be toggled. We'll go back to our function test. Bank 1, sensor 1. I'll turn that relay on real quick here. So turn that on. I just heard the relay click. Off on. So turn that on a couple times. Let's see now if we have a code, what code we have for bank 1, sensor 1. Just out of curiosity. Codes. Okay, so I don't know if you guys can see. So yeah, we just have that low circuit code for bank 1 sensor 1. So there you have it. It will not set a heater failure code simply by unplugging it. Chances are we may have an intermittent failure in that O2 sensor. Fact of the matter is I cannot call the customer and say your O2 sensor is bad, you need a new one, simply because that would be a lie, because currently it works. What I can do though is inform him of my opinion on that, in the fact that it may be failing. It's probably a very cheap O2 sensor to buy. I guess if it was my vehicle, I would change it, based on this, or maybe I wouldn't. Because I don't have to pay for, my auto repairs, but I'm just going to give him my opinions on that, and then I'm going to see if I can find that connector below, and then we'll leave it up to this guy, see what he does. As far as this oil pressure sensor volt, I don't believe that is a check engine light setting code. These have, a tremendously high failure rate on the oil pressure switch. I'm going to assume it's that. Of course, we'll go here and we can take a look at it. It does display the data on that. We'll see if we can just check that real quick too. Just kind of give them a full estimate here. I'll see if I can find oil pressure. Oil pressure right now is at 0.0 PSI. What we can do. I'll blow that up in a graph for you so you guys can see that. There's no reason we can't start this beast. Start it up here. Let's see, get my wires out of the fan. Fire in the hole! Running 39, of course we had this little high spike of 118, about 40 PSI. Seems to be kind of fixed. I know this Jeep's not running at 40 PSI consistently. See if we can get back here. Take this back through the air. That's kind of frustrating. Where is it? Oil pressure, zero. Guess we'll just see if we get the same results here. Yeah, this time it just went up to 40. Kind of stayed there, so hey, we better check that out. So we got our data pin pulled up here. We've got our oil pressure voltage. So almost 5 volts there. Our actual oil pressure, which is 0 PSI. Right up there, above our starter, that's our oil pressure sensor. Okay, it's got that lovely red lock in it. So what we'll do, I assume this works like, I think it's a single. It looks to me like a single wire. So it's probably fed 5 volts from the PCM, which we can see here, and then it's pulled to ground. I'd have to look this up to be sure, but then it's probably pulled to ground and, you know, variable in any variable in between. 5 volts obviously being open circuit and 0 PSI. So what we can do is we can unplug it. We'll just give a quick bypass test to see. We'll monitor our voltage. I don't know if it'll interpret, you know, oil pressure without the engine running, but we can take and start it up. We'll just take and unplug it, see if that goes, see what that does. That should theoretically, I guess, stay at 5 volts, right? That would be my assumption, and then it has to be pulled to ground for work. I think the lower the voltage, the higher the oil pressure. Okay, so it is a single wire. Okay, oops. All right, well, this is kind of odd. Our voltage went to 1.52 volts. I'm gonna do some thinking here. What am I missing? What am I thinking wrong? Okay, so we left off underneath with this test light doing what I thought was going to be a simple bypass test on a single wire oil pressure, what I assume to be sending unit, simply because it has a gauge. Long story short, I did the bypass test. I didn't like what it was doing as far as what we were reading on the scan data. You know, 5 volts plugged in, unplugged it, assumed 5 volts was going to stay, but it didn't. But when you grounded it with a test light, the voltage went back high. That to me didn't make any sense. So I stopped right there, shut the camera off, thought, figured I better do some looking here to kind of see what's going on. I'm gonna share with you what I found. Basically what I did is I just gathered my data. I looked at scan data, seen what it says, open circuit, you know, essentially shorted circuit, bypass test, short to ground with a test light. Wasn't making any sense whatsoever. Busted out the voltmeter and gathered some real data of what the wire was actually doing versus what, you know, scan tool was telling us it was doing, it was still kind of bizarre, like really bizarre. Like, why is it doing what it's doing? Gathered all my data, gave it some thought, figured that must be just how this system works. Thought I'd look for some theory and operation on Mitchell, you know, on Protomand, you know, check IATN and SureTrack to see if there was any theory and operation on there. Answer to that is no, there's not. There was no help anywhere other than, you know, wing a bunch of parts at it, which is, you know, silly. I want to know how the system worked. Nothing explains it anywhere as I could find. Gathered my data, seen how the system works, the best that I could tell. Did what anybody would do, called their buddy. So I called Ivan, said, Ivan, listen to this, gave him my data. He thought the same thing I did, is like, that's ridiculous. You know, how does this system work like that? But long story short, him and I both agreed that this is just how this system works. Why it has a gauge, I still don't know. All I do know, it's a Jeep thing, and I wouldn't understand, and I still don't. So if you have one of these Jeeps and you have an oil pressure gauge in it, forget about it, because your oil pressure gauge is phony. It doesn't do anything other than indicate whether you have oil pressure or you have no oil pressure. That's it. It tells you nothing other than that, at least on this particular model, because the sending unit that's in here is not a sending unit. It's simply your regular classic single wire oil pressure switch, either open or closed, and that's all you have. Over on the whiteboard, I took and jotted down actual readings versus scan tool readings, which is process data. Why the scan tool does with it what it does, I don't know. And at this point, I really don't care why it does what it does, but I do know, you know, real versus, you know, process. I'm gonna show that to you. And then that way there, if you guys ever get one of these and you're questioning, is this circuit good or isn't it good? Well, I've got the data to show you now, and I think it's the only data anywhere that I found. So I'll try to represent this the best that I can quickly so it doesn't take up a ton of video time, because it's a single wire oil pressure switch. It's ridiculous. Why does this have a gauge? It made me crazy. ECM, single wire. It's a 5-volter-ish, 5.2 something I was measuring on it. Goes to an oil pressure switch, which is either open or closed. And then this wire comes down. Well, it's not a wire. Start over here. ECM, 5-volt wire, oil pressure switch goes to the ground. The switch can either open or it can close. It is not infinitely adjustable to give a varying reading on a gauge. This can simply turn a light on and off, or in this case, make a gauge go up and down, and that's it. Completely ridiculous. Totally fools you. So, with no oil pressure in the system, this switch is closed. It's shorted to ground. Okay, makes sense. With oil pressure greater than, you know, 5 psi or whatever the threshold is of the switch from the manufacturer, it goes open circuit. So it's just basically like unplugging the connector. So that makes you think, well, if I just unplug it, will my gauge show oil pressure? You win the prize. That's right. Want oil pressure on your Jeep? Unplug the switch. Gauge goes up. Everybody's happy. And it reads right at 40 psi. That's just the programmed number in this ECM. Totally silly. Here's real data. This is with the voltmeter. This key on, engine off, 0.42 volts. That's a little bit high. This should be pulling it straight to ground. Our switch has some resistance in it. Like, I don't remember what it was, I measured it. 24 ohms, 42 ohms, something like that. It has a little bit of resistance. It should go straight to ground. It's gonna get a new switch because it won't go straight to ground. No big deal. So, but you can see that this is low voltage. Compared to scan data, process data, 4.9 volts, 4.98. Why? I don't know. I'm not a computer nerd. Key on, engine running, real life data, 5.25 volts. Has oil pressure, so this is open circuited, so that is essentially just like unplugging the wire. I did unplug it, voltage doesn't change. Unplugged, plugged in, running, 5.25 volts. Scan tool data, 1.49 volts. Why? Again, I don't know. But it is what it is. I know that sounds cliche. Your gauge in these is fake. It doesn't do anything other than tell you that you either have or you don't have oil pressure. Here's how it works. Best I can do for you. So there, yeehaw, did I spend way too much time on an oil pressure switch. Oh, you betcha. Was it worth it? Sure, I got some data. I learned something, Ivan learned something. We all learned something. Are we gonna remember it? Probably not. The part's about 15 bucks. You get one in with an oil pressure switch code. You slap a $15 oil pressure switch in it because that's a fraction of the cost that it would be to actually diagnose it. And you leave it at that. Code comes back, well, chase it down. That sounds like a part swapping move. It is. But what can I say? You know, like I say, the part is like super, super cheap. And sometimes, in some cases, it is much easier to replace than it is to test. And, you know, I know there's other channels out there that would really scoff at that and say that's incorrect. But in some cases, when the part is so ridiculously cheap and it's such a high failure item, that's just fact of life, baby. And that's just how it is. So just got off the phone with a guy. Said, do it. No estimate. Don't even tell him what's wrong. Just wants it fixed. Doesn't want the light on. O2 sensor. Got that baby coming. That has apparently some kind of intermittent problem with the heater. O2 sensors for these vehicles are super cheap. NTK is the OE maker of it, so I just get an NTK one, you know, down at Napper. Oil pressure switch. Got one of those coming because it's stuck a little bit high and will not pull all the way to ground. So that's coming. What else do we have? Pigtail for that other O2 sensor. I ordered that right from Jeep themselves, the people, the men. Got that there. That's coming. That'll be here in the morning. So we'll fix that little pigtail that's all busted up down there and broke off. And then we'll take and run this beast through a drive cycle. Make sure it's all good. I'll finish looking it over for inspection. See if we can get this little guy's sticker. And that's it. Move on with life. So it'll be tomorrow for me, but just a few seconds for you. So stay tuned. We're back. It's a new day. And I see I screwed up the video looking through the footage there yesterday. And I see somehow I missed the bypass test with the O2 sensor. But let me just run that down real quick. Oh, I did that. Must have neglected to hit the record button. Life problems, I guess. Let's see. So here's our new oil pressure switch. So single wire, just like we talked about. And all I had done to do the bypass test, single wire, had 5 volts on it. I'd hooked my test light to ground on the transmission, touched this on the single wire that feeds this, and on the scan data, that's when I expected that to go down to 0 volts, but instead it went high. But we already explained that on the whiteboard, but thought I'd want to take a minute to clarify that because I didn't realize I botched that until yesterday, in which case it was too late. Got the brand new O2 sensor. I bought a NTK, so that's the OEM maker of these. And then got an oil pressure switch. I'm gonna take and swap these little guys out. Still waiting on Chrysler to bring us our connector. It's still pretty early in the morning. They usually don't get here till, you know, 9, 10 o'clock or so. So when that gets here, we'll swap that connector out too. And then we'll take this thing for a drive and see if it gets run a full drive cycle and see if that was all the problems with this thing. Well, our friends at Chrysler let us down. The connector they got for us was the wrong one. So we were at my second favorite place in the world, the junkyard. We're gonna see if we can find us a Grand Cherokee that perhaps still has this connector in it. I already looked in that little green one right there, but that's a 99. And that had a round style connector. I think the Jeeps are all the way out back here. Oh no, hey look, there's a Grand Cherokee right there. I wonder what that is. Looks like probably an older one. Yeah, I think that's older. Let's see, what year is this thing? Shoot, this one's a 99. That regular Cherokee I just looked on, that was a 99 too. Where's the little donger? I can feel ya. Let's see. got my new snips. Viewers sent me. Yeah, shoot, that's got a round connector on it. Wrong one.
All right, let's keep on trucking. You know, it might fit in other Chryslers, but we know it'll fit the Cherokee, so or Grand Cherokee. So we'll see if we can find one. You know, the same year. Cherokee. Maybe an older one. We'll go take a look here. Wire harnesses are probably all cut out of them anyways. That's a 2001. Let's see. Come on, baby. It's like playing the lotto. All the freaking harnesses are cut. And they don't have any 4 liters on the shelf. That's the first thing I asked. So yeah, they cut the engine harness. I was really hoping that this might have stayed. Ah, shoot. We're almost gonna have to find one with an engine in it, which they claimed they didn't have. And all the converters are probably on a shelf somewhere. Yeah, I'm gonna keep poking. Well, I've been down the whole Chrysler row here, not having any success. Everything is missing, engines, harnesses, everything. They've been picked pretty well clean. I'm gonna run inside, see if they got any engines on the shelf. He said he didn't, but I'm gonna look at some other Chryslers, see if I can find the connector. Dang. Well, I went inside and poked around for longer than I should have. No bueno. We're heading back to the compound. I did grab an O2 sensor off a Kallik burner that was laying out there in a cart, and it has male pins in it. Let's see if we can leash yank the pin out of it. You know, it'll be the wrong wire color, but maybe we can use it. So here's a little connector I got. It's off an actual O2 sensor, but I think get a little pick, we can this has the little male terminals in it, and that's what we have up there. I think we could probably make something work. A little frustrating. Oops. So I'll see if I can't get this poked apart here. Get a couple. We only need two of these if possible, and then we should be in good shape, assuming they're the same style here. I think they are. So there's there's a little male terminal there. I'll have to pull one out of that connector to see if they're the same. I don't know if they are. Hopefully. Well, no beans. Here's the one out of the vehicle. Here's the one I got down there. Two different styles, so it won't click in. These are such a fine crimp, you really can't, you know, open them up and reuse them. You know, they're pretty delicate. Just not enough wire on there to reuse. Well, figure something out. Well, we might lose some subscribers over this little bit. I did what I had to do. We chopped it off. What are you gonna do? That's what we gotta do. So I cut it short. It's not a big deal. It's just gonna have to be repaired in the future if we can get the correct connector from Chrysler, or perhaps, you know, these correct male terminals here. You know, fact of the matter is I just don't have hours to spend in the salvage yard, you know, trying to find them, nor do I have these, these male type connectors that are specific to this connector. This OT sensor and these things are really inexpensive. So I chopped it off. And we did a little crimp and seal, and we're gonna be good. Plenty of wire there.
it's not really a hack, so to speak, but it's what we had to do to get the job done. I did make an attempt to remove the wire from the pin. You can open it up and you can take the weather pack portion of it off, but that's about it. These things are crimped on there really nicely. There's a special tool to crimp them on, so I didn't want to rig it up. Chop it off. So there it is. Like I said, just cut the connector off, crimp and seal. These are all heat shrinked and sealed on there good. So we'll just put the white poly loom back over it, and I'll put a little tape on that poly loom, and this will be as good a repair as we can make right now. Sometimes you just gotta do what you gotta do, As long as it's safe, not something silly, this is not silly in my opinion. And I did take down, what was it? They had that the thing that originally cut the wires, had that little loop, like up here or something. I'm just gonna make sure we got plenty of wire there, and we'll just wire tie this back, to the harness. And I think that'll be better than what it was. At least it's not gonna chafe through and, rub another hole in it. Go. Taking running out on a drive cycle, let's sit here and warm up for a smidge. There's the parts we ended up changing. I elected to do that rear O2. I had that, potentially intermittent heater problem. Like I said, these things are quite cheap. We did do the oil pressure switch, and this does now pull all the way down to 0 volts. So that's good. Seen the air filter was pretty trash, we had that out. So we popped a new air filter in it. Now he's gotta run it through a drive cycle and do a couple other things that he wants done while it's here. And main concern with this portion of it was the check engine light. So I cleared the codes on it yesterday. And what I'll do, I like to use this little Actron scanner, code reader, whatever you want to call it, for doing drive cycles, because it actually has a little drive cycle monitor on it. It's kind of nice. Get it lined up there. So I'll plug this in and get this up. I don't think these Jeeps, I don't think we'll get it to run the EVAP. I can't remember on these if they got to go two times or what the story is. And I think the O2 heater test on these runs once the vehicle's turned off. So we'll see. I'll go on, we'll run it here, and we'll see what we can figure out. Okay, so I got all the information in here. Go down, like I said, this has a drive cycle monitor section, so pick on that, and then that brings up our monitors that aren't set yet. Oop, I just must have yanked it out here. Yeah, you get the gist on that. So there's our three monitors that aren't set. Maybe it doesn't have an EVAP monitor, maybe it ran it when we sat here, fired it up, maybe it ran a leak detection pump, I'm not sure. But so O2 sensor, heater, and catalyst. All I'm worried about is the O2 heater, and that oil pressure business there, that was a continuous monitor, so that'll throw a code at any point. Gorgeous out yesterday, a little rainy day. It's kind of stuffy, about 60 something, 62, well, according to this Jeep here, 64. Muggy, hot, humid, Well, just driving down the road here, I did poke into the data stream, making sure those O2 sensors are working. And I'm not so sure how we're going to get through this without Cadillac converter codes. Those downstream O2 sensors are switching at the same exact rate as the upstream. I'll be really shocked if we don't get, classic P0420, 430. I don't know. I did neglect to look at the monitors prior to working on this. So that's always the potential rookie mistake. I didn't check monitors first. In which case I should have. We've got 165,800 miles on this thing. It's plausible that these converters are toast. You know, looking at the scan data, they ain't working at all.
Yeah, I got nothing yet. Oh, just got catalyst, didn't we? Did we seriously just get the catalyst monitor? There's no way. Let's see if it set a pending code here. I'll be shocked if it didn't. I mean, they don't even remotely work. No codes, that is unbelievable. Well, whatever. If Jeep's happy, I'm happy. Like I say, we'll get the O2 sensor heater, I believe, or maybe the monitor. One of those two, we'll get those when we get back to the shop and let it sit, I don't know, 5 minutes key off or something like that.
Made it back to home base. O2 heater. The only two left. I just worry about the heater one. So when I'm concerned about 95% certain on these Chryslers that monitor runs key off. So we will leave the old Actron right here in the old Jeep. I've got a bunch of other stuff to do. I'll come back out in a while and we'll kick this back on and look and check for any pending codes or anything like that. Completely shocked we don't have Cadillac converter codes. Thankful but shocked. This must be very tolerant of the catalyst efficiency because they didn't work even like minutely. So whatever, is what it is. We'll be back. Let's go out and see if this baby is ready. Plug her back in so she fires up. Her door dinger is like the most annoying thing ever. Man, just got my computer all wet. There, fixed. Clean the screen. Let's see what our previous. These are handy. If you got nothing, these little guys are pretty good. I use this thing all the time when it's quick and easy and come out in the parking lot with it. So let's see. Well, let's go to read codes first. Kind of codes we got. No codes there. I thought I had some codes back in the beginning. Must be all ABS codes maybe. Yep. Huh. Bunch of ABS stuff. We ain't worried about that. We're just worried about these little guys' engine codes. No codes. Of course, we already just looked at that. Go down to drive cycle monitor. All supported monitors are okay. So it ran a full drive cycle. We should be able to look at that in another way right here. I am monitors. And we can see they're all okay, except for the ones that are not available. Right on. Perfect. So I guess the O2 and the O2 heater both run on this Chrysler when the key shut off. I knew it was something like that. I guess one last look at the oil pressure gauge there. That's it. She's a fakie. Even when you rev it up, oil pressure doesn't move. Of course, we know that theoretically it's impossible. It can't. It's nothing more than a switch. So, key on, you know, we're at low. Of course, you'd get a check gauges light that would come on, but as soon as you start it, regardless of the oil pressure, it's always going to go to the halfway point. Because the PCM sends the signal to the instrument cluster on the bus wire telling the cluster that we have 40 PSI. And that must be just due to the programming and stuff of this particular vehicle. All right, so we'll leave it at that. This beast is fixed and confirmed in a full drive cycle and no code, so we can't ask for anything better. Wish we could have found an O2 sensor connector, but you know, it's an 04, 166,000 miles on it almost. As long as that O2 sensor never fails again, we're good. You know, I can't see any other reason unhook it unless you're, you know, put an engine in this thing or something, which, you know, I doubt if the engine blew in this thing. You know, you guys seen it. She's pretty crusty, so I doubt a guy would, you know, spend the money for an engine or anything like that. You know, fact of the matter is, if you need to unhook it, you could always just cut it. And then, like I say, if it ever did fail again in the future, you know, you could always get the connector and stuff then. So I'm just justifying my action there, folks, okay? That's it. Facebook, Google Plus, all that business. Check us out there. Subscribe to our channel if you want to watch more sweet repair videos and attempted repair videos and such. We post all the good, bad, and the ugly all at the same time. So do that. Stick around. Thanks for watching. And remember, viewers, if I can do it, you can do it.